All right. That's going to do it for us today, folks. I am tired, Matt. Thank you. Nice job today.
Thank you. Great
good,
job.
Good top 10 list today.
Yeah, thank you. Awesome seeing it. You, Kyle.
I like it. Yeah, always awesome seeing you.
Thank you, Kyle.
I'm so happy to be back.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
Did you get the donut? All right, let's get it together here. We have Matt Connerton Unleashed coming up at 4 p.m., followed by Robbio's The Majestic Theaters Through the Stage Door. And, of course, if you missed it last Friday, I don't know what Shannon was talking about, but you can check out Retro Spectrum Radio, and that'll be tonight at 7 o'clock, up here, right? Okay. All right, thanks everybody who called in, and everybody in our Facebook Live room, thank you. We appreciate you. We love you. Now go home now.
Run.
All right. Adios, folks.
This hour on WMNH is sponsored by CGI Business Solutions, located at 5 Dartmouth Drive in Auburn. They serve all your business needs, including employee benefits planning, corporate design and business administration, investments and wealth management, and customized business insurance solutions. Their phone number is 866-841-4600 or on the web at cgibusinesssolutions.com.
Bring your kitchen to life with Queen City Cabinetry, located at 87 Elm Street in the historic Sunbeam Mall in Manchester. Open Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., and Saturdays, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. They can be reached at 603-222-2007 or on the web at queencitycabinetrynh.com. Come see the possibilities. Queen City Cabinetry, another proud sponsor of WMNH.
Clemento's Pizzeria, family friendly, awesome for a date night. Clemento's Pizzeria.
For delivery, call 603-782-8450.
Clemento's Pizzeria, the best pizza in town.
1875 South Willow Street in Manchester, New Hampshire.
Best cocktails around.
Come in as friends and leave as family.
Come on down to the Hop Knot at 1000 Elm Street, Manchester's premier craft beer and gourmet pretzel bar. Tell us more, Trudy.
We make our dough fresh every day. We make a variety of styles of pretzels and serve craft beer, cocktails, and a few bottles of wine. We do the traditional pretzel, and we have multiple flavors for that. We also do stuffed pretzels, pretzel sandwiches, free dessert pretzels, and pretzel knots.
The Hop Knot in the Brady Sullivan Plaza at 1000 Elm Street.
You are listening to WMNHLP, Manchester's radio, broadcasting at 95.3 megahertz frequency modulation from the top of 1000 Elm Street. Our studios are located at 1045 Elm Street and licensed to Manchester Public Television Service in Manchester, New Hampshire, USA.
For the millions of refugees of this war who found a welcome in Europe and the United States, particularly here in Poland. Ordinary people all across Europe did whatever they could to help and continue to do so. Polish businesses, civil society, cultural leaders, including the First Lady of Poland, who is here tonight, have led with the heart and determination, showcasing all that's good about the human spirit. Madam First Lady, we love you. Thank you all. I'll never forget last year visiting with refugees from Ukraine who had just arrived in Warsaw, seeing their faces, exhausted and afraid, holding their children so close, worrying they might never see their fathers, their husbands, their brothers, their sisters again. In that darkest moment of their lives, you, the people of Poland, offered them safety and light. You embraced them. You literally embraced them. I watched. I watched the looks on their faces. Meanwhile, together we made sure that Russia is paying the price for its abuses. We continue to maintain the largest sanction regime ever imposed in any country in history. And we're going to announce more sanctions this week together with our partners. We'll hold accountable those who are responsible for this war, and we'll seek justice for the war crimes and crimes against humanity continuing to be committed by the Russians. You know, there's much for us to be proud of over all that we have achieved together this past year. But we have to be honest and clear-eyed as we look at the year ahead. The defense of freedom is not the work of a day or of a year. It's always difficult. It's always important. As Ukraine continues to defend itself against the Russian onslaught and launch counteroffensives of its own, there will continue to be hard and very bitter days, victories and tragedies. But Ukraine is steel for the fight ahead. And the United States, together with our allies and partners, are going to continue to have Ukraine's back as it defends itself. Next year, I will host every member of NATO for our 2024 summit in the United States. Together, we'll celebrate the 75th anniversary of the strongest defensive alliance in the history of the world, NATO. And let there be no doubt, the commitment of the United States to our NATO alliance and Article 5 is rock solid. And every member of NATO knows it. And Russia knows it as well. An attack against one is an attack against all. It's a sacred oath. Sacred oath to defend every inch of NATO territory. Over the past year, the United States has come together with our allies and partners in an extraordinary coalition to stand against Russian aggression. But the work in front of us is not just what we're against. It's about what we're for. What kind of world do we want to build? We need to take the strength and capacity of this coalition and apply it to lifting up the lives of people everywhere, improving health, growing prosperity, preserving the planet, building peace and security, treating everyone with dignity and respect. That's our responsibility. The democracies of the world have to deliver it for our people. As we gather tonight, the world, in my view, is at an inflection point. The decisions we make over the next 5 years or so are going to determine and shape our lives for decades to come. That's true for Americans. It's true for the people of the world. And while decisions are ours to make now, the principles and the stakes are eternal. The choice between chaos and stability, between building and destroying, between hope and fear, between democracy that lifts up the human spirit and the brutal hand of the dictator who crushes it, between nothing less than limitation and possibilities, the kind of possibilities that come when people who live not in captivity but in freedom. 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 There is no sweeter word than freedom. There is no nobler goal than freedom. There's no higher aspiration than freedom. Americans know that, and you know it. And all that we do now must be done so our children and grandchildren will know it as well. Freedom. The enemy of the tyrant and the hope of the brave and the truth of the ages, freedom. Stand with us. We will stand with you. Let us move forward with faith and conviction and with an abiding commitment to be allies, not of darkness but of light, not of oppression but of liberation, not of captivity but, yes, of freedom. May God bless you all. May God protect our troops. And may God bless the heroes of Ukraine and all those who defend freedom around the world. Thank you, Poland. Thank you, thank you, thank you for what you're doing. God bless you all.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. It's that time again. Matt Connerton Unleashed, and we are live from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM in glorious downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. Boy, my voice is hoarse. I can hear it in my headphones. I'm still, I'm not 100% apparently from my recent illness. It's in my throat, but I'm sure I'm not contagious at this point. So don't anybody worry too much. But oh my, I can hear it though. I sound like I've been gargling with some gravel, whereas I usually with my dulcet tones I usually sound like I've been gargling with honey, although I don't actually like honey. It's too sweet for me. I actually find honey disgusting anyway. But welcome everybody. Of course, we are live from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM in glorious downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. Also on Comcast 97 if you're in Manchester. And hello to all of our online listeners across the nation and around the globe. You can go to my website, mattconnerton.com, for all your live streaming options, social media links, contact info, show archives, etc., etc. Today is Tuesday, February 21, 2023. So welcome, and we've got an exciting program for you today. Well, we have much to talk about, and also I believe our friend EZG, Eric Gagnon, is going to be calling in soon to do a to do an entertainment report for us. And, oh, I've got a story to tell him. Oh, man, you are not going to believe. He is not going to believe. And I mean that literally, because he thinks I make these up. But I swear I would never do that. He is not going to believe the story that I have to tell and to share with everyone what happened to me today. It's just shocking, my friends, just shocking. By the way, also a quick programming note. I know we had said we were going to do it today. We're going to hold this for one more day. We have Eric Pilcher's classic film review, and we didn't air it last Friday like we normally would because I wasn't here. So we were going to run it today instead. We're actually going to hold it to tomorrow only because our friend Eric Pilcher cannot be in the chat room today. He has an appointment, and he likes to be in the chat room while the review airs so he can answer questions, respond to feedback and whatnot. And I said, well, let's we'll hold it for Wednesday. We'll do it Wednesday. The film is Juice. Eric has been, of course, reviewing a series of films that he feels are appropriate for Black History Month, as it is such month. And so Juice is the review. So you will hear that tomorrow. And then Friday's review this week, the to cap off Black History Month, is Do the Right Thing, the great Spike Lee film. But I believe our friend EZG is on the line. Eric, is that you?
Yeah, I believe so. Hey, welcome back.
Thank you. It's good to be back.
Yeah, repeats just aren't the same, you know?
Yes.
I think the one was MC Hammer again. It's like, oh, no, goodbye to that one. Oh.
Right. Well, you know, I get very nervous about, yes, I do get nervous when the, and for those who don't know, Easy is referring to the best of episodes that play. If for some reason I cannot be here, one of our classic best of episodes plays. And I am working on producing some new ones of those, by the way. So we have some new ones in the mix.
Yeah.
But if something happens and I'm not able to be here, a best of automatically plays. And MC Hammer, right. I'll tell you, I did have quite the epic feud with MC Hammer. It was Hammer time around here, and it was very frightening. People think MC Hammer, oh, he's such a nice guy. He wears the genie pants. He does the dance. He says you can't touch this. Yeah. But he was.
We don't really hear from that guy anymore.
We don't.
Out of the loop.
And it's a big relief. Easy, but I do have a story to tell you. You're not going to believe this.
I bet you do.
Are you ready for this? Are you ready for story time? All right, this is...
story time with Matt. Yep.
Story time with Matt. This is unbelievable what happened to me, Easy. This is going to be shocking.
So
this is going to be quite. This is going to be quite shocking. Okay, so today, this afternoon, I'm driving, and I'm just driving along, minding my own business, and somebody cuts me off. I'm in traffic. Another driver cuts me off in traffic. And now, look, I'm not a big road rage guy. It doesn't get you anything.
That's a good thing.
Yeah, and what's to get upset about anyway? Everybody makes mistakes, right? I mean, I've certainly done it. You know,
Mr. Rogers would say, do you ever make mistakes?
Right. I've certainly cut people off in traffic inadvertently, you know. It happens,
oh, yeah,
right?
Oh, sure.
But this particular instance bothered me. I have to tell you, I was bothered because it seemed as though the way the other driver did it, it seemed as though it was intentional. Like they cut me off intentionally. I was quite bothered. I was a little hot over it. I'm not gonna lie. In fact, Easy, and forgive me for using rough language here, but I have to do it. I was significantly peeved. Yeah. Oh yeah, I was. I apologize. I hope there's no children listening, but yeah, I was peeved. So you know, there's two lanes on our side of the road. So we get to a traffic light, a stoplight, and I pull up next. I normally would never do this, but I was upset. I pulled up next to the guy, put my window down, and I said, "Hey, you cut me off back there." And he already had hit his window down. He was ready for me, and he goes, "Yeah, well, you know what? There's a lot more cutting where that came from, Connerton." And I was like, "Whoa, what are you talking about? Yeah, how do you know my name?" And he goes, "Listen to this, Easy. This is shock. This chilled me to the bone." He goes, "Well, how about you just take this as a little bit of a warning from a certain mutual acquaintance of ours?" And I said, "Wait a minute, a mutual acquaintance? Who are you talking about? Who sent you?" And he looks me right in the eyes and he goes, "I'll tell you exactly who sent me. His name is Bruce." And Easy, I was so shocked by this. I couldn't believe this was happening.
Yeah, I think before, and sorry, I was, the last 3 weeks.
I was so upset. And again, I was quite peeved.
You were.
I was quite peeved. And I sat there. And with both hands, I started digging my fingernails into the steering wheel. I was so upset. And I looked up at the ceiling and I went, "Bruce!" I couldn't believe it.
Boy.
And then the other guy drove off.
Yeah, I can't believe it either.
Well, you gotta have a talk with that guy. Because now I feel like he's putting my life in danger.
Yeah.
So
I don't think so.
Call off the dogs.
You're
if you wouldn't
make
mind.
Up all these stories.
What? Okay. Answer me this honestly. What kind of a sick freak would make up stories like this? I mean, come on.
I think it's you.
I can assure you.
I think when you get home, I think you get home, Jenny's going to say, "Well, another ridiculous story."
No, when I get home, she.
I remember the last time I did my report. She was there, and she said, "said Matt, she didn't believe that story."
When I get home, she will come running and throw her arms around me and say, "Oh my God, are you okay? I can't believe that happened to you." That's what'll happen.
Yeah, I have a feeling it's not going to happen.
Oh no, that's exactly what will happen.
Yeah.
How do you know? You won't be there. You're right there, Ease?
I am, yeah.
Good.
I'm falling asleep to hear full of stories.
Oh, wow. That's hurtful. How could that be? My story is exciting. My story that I just told you, Easy, that was like a mini action adventure movie. That could be a movie. It was like a Fast and Furious trailer. Fast and Furious 18 with Vin Diesel with a walker or something.
Oh, boy.
I mean, it was pretty exciting. You're just jealous. Exciting things don't happen to you.
I don't think it is. It's one of your made up stories.
Well, that hurts me. That hurts me.
Yeah.
It hurts. It hurts that you think that of me. I'm a paragon of virtue.
It's going to be a small report. I don't have much to.
I'm like George Washington with the tree.
There's not much out there right now. So.
The truth is out there, Easy. Haven't you ever seen the X-Files?
Yeah. I looked on their Facebook and stuff, but it really, There really wasn't a lot of stuff, so it won't take too long for my report today.
Basically, nothing going on. Is that your report?
Well, some stuff going on, but it's not.
Oh, good. Oh, good. Well, would you like to do that? Shall I play your music?
Yeah, it won't be a 45-minute report today.
No. Oh. Well, that's
unfortunately. I looked around, but there wasn't really much going on. Uh-huh. Unfortunately. Mm.
You want to know about stock market crashes, COVID-19, drive-bys, celebrity gossip? Easy G's gotcha. Entertainment Report style.
That's why I'm easy.
Because ain't nothing but a G thing, baby.
Are you ready for stock time?
Let's find out. Ready, set, go.
Yeah.
And by the way,
dedicate this one to a guy who just showed up. Gary plays the piano. They actually had finger food today, which was really nice.
Whoa, finger food! Lucky.
Yeah, some chicken, some spinach stuff, and little cheese balls. Boy, it's really good.
Yeah, so that's at the assisted living facility where you reside. They have finger food and cheese balls.
Yeah, that was, and he always plays an excellent job on the piano.
What's his name? Gary.
He's the best guy that comes here.
Yeah, and what does he play on the piano? What kind of songs?
Oh, honky-tonk music.
He plays honky-tonk.
Old stuff.
Living the life.
50s.
By the way, I just want you to know, Easy, that Jason Fetterson in the chat room says, I'm so happy that you are still alive, Matt. Thank you. See, someone's concerned for me and my safety.
Oh, boy.
Mm-hmm. And I appreciate it.
All right. The one that's got the most going on is Katie Dobbins. Obviously, new music coming this year. I don't know when it's coming out. And she'll be announced, I guess. And then she's doing a lot of stuff right now, which is great. February 22nd at 7 o'clock. And, tickets are $15. It's called the Songwriters Roundup. She's in charge of this, I guess. Yes, she's in charge. It's her gig at Herman Woods Winery in Meredith. And that's on, 6 o'clock doors, 7... Oh, yeah, 6:30. 6 o'clock doors, 6:30. I have taste some wine. And the show 7, 8:30.
Is that what they do at a wine tasting?
Wine tasting, yeah. You can taste some wine.
Taste some wine at the wine tasting.
You can show us on February 22nd.
Uh-huh.
February 25th. Mm-hmm. March 1st. And
uh-huh.
March 3rd.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah, March 10th is going to be all Katie Dobbins.
Mm-hmm.
There's other dates, too, but we'll get into another time.
Oh, by the way, Easy, as a means of congratulating Katie on these shows that you're announcing, our amazing sponsor, the Hop Knot, Kenny from the Hop Knot was here yesterday, and he requested, and he is a sponsor, so I feel obligated to do it. He requested that we bring back the air horn.
Oh, yeah, you haven't played that in a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was good, Kenny, on the radio. It's been a long time.
Had been a long time,
in March 10th. Elements of book, coffee, and beer. Oh, yeah, $15 for the tickets for the last event.
Books, coffee, and
in
beer.
Bickford, Maine. And they don't have price to get in because it's a book, coffee place. But they will have a donation jar. So a donation jar.
Uh-huh, donation jar.
And then March 16th, a Bell Brook series featuring... tickets at the door at $10, 6:30 doors, 7 p.m. show. That'll be Katie Dobbins. And then, I already talked about that show.
Uh-huh. Oh, Jason Fetterson.
Oh, yeah, I messed up here. Every Wednesday, she's going to be doing a songwriter on February 22nd and then March 29th and then April 26th and May 31st.
And there's
a lot of tickets available at the door for the Bell Brick series featuring Laconia. Tickets are $10 at the door, 6:30 doors and 7 p.m. show.
I feel like this would be so much easier if you had a tablet.
Yeah, well, he has, stuff going on at the,
Uh-huh. Got some stuff going on. Oh, by the way, J-Fed really loves the air horn, so we gotta give the people what they want, Easy. Gotta give the people what they want.
The same thing twice.
Oh, maybe,
Is he gonna play every Wednesday? On the songwriters, and then they do other dates too.
Uh-huh.
Every Wednesday and more dates.
Every Wednesday and more dates. That's very concise.
Well, February 25th, March 1st, March 12th, March 3rd, March 10th with Katie.
Uh huh.
And March 28th, March 31st, and then every Wednesday, Then there's March 4th, March 11th, March 18th, March 21st, March 25th, and April Fool's Day. They are throwing in a couple of other Wednesday dates, apparently. I mean, other date besides Wednesday. That would make any sense, yes.
Right. Yeah.
So they're throwing every Wednesday and other dates. You could get a hold of...
Got it.
You get a hold of...
It's crystal clear.
Winery... Live event at Herman Woods and Winery in Meredith to get more information.
Herman's Woods? That sounds like a dangerous place to go. Herman's Woods? I don't go out in the woods where there's hermits and Hermans and Herman's Hermits.
I'm going to round up a live event at the Hermit Woods Winery.
Hermit Woods.
Left Meredith.
Doesn't that sound creepy? I don't like to go in the woods generally, though, EZG. And there's two reasons for this. Number one, I'm terrified at the prospect of encountering deer ticks and ending up with Lyme disease. And number two, I've seen the Blair Witch Project. I know what can happen. I don't want to end up having to stand in the corner of some weird basement.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, anyways, not much going on with April Cushman here, but he does have every Wednesday at 6 o'clock at Killington River Shop and tickets. It's a ticketed event every Wednesday.
Yes.
And then it's going to be an event here on Thursday, but I have a feeling it's going to be canceled because of weather. So I won't even announce it because they're probably going to cancel it due to weather.
Well,
Jones is getting into it.
Probably
be canceled. Yeah. There's a big storm coming.
I don't think it's a big storm.
Ice and all that fun stuff.
It'll be fine. The show will go on.
So anyways,
we'll go on.
About that. And then
it's happening.
Oh, yeah, here we go.
I decree it.
Here we go.
Let's stake my life on it.
Yeah.
It'll be happening.
That air is not good radio. Anyways,
agreed.
Joe and Dave are the contacts in ConcordCoachman.org to get more information. They sing barber-style music. If you love that stuff, you can leave a message, and they will get a hold of you. I think it's $50 a gig.
By the way,
too bad, you know?
Paulie C in the chat room says DJ Steve actually sat in with Herman's Hermits. Were you
really?
Were you at that show? Did they do that at the facility there?
No, but I'm trying to get the Coastman to come, so we'll see what happens.
Yes.
It's out of my hands. I just give her the information, so whatever happens, it doesn't. That's okay. Either way, it's okay.
Oh, JFed in the chat room.
Anyway, another fun event. You love these events. Annual St. Patrick's Day Parade.
Yeah.
Down Elm Street, rain or shine. Only time they won't have it is the torrential rain, because they can't.
Torrential rain is bad, yes.
They canceled it before other parades. Anyways, March 26th at high noon, 11 a.m., St. Patrick's Day Shuffle. A fun time for all.
By the way, JFed in the chat room says, we need a lot more horn and cowbell if you have it. I don't have cowbell handy, but I do have more horn.
Oh, boy. Yeah, I listened to and watched it. Yeah, the Bell Center in Montreal, kind of the. And we're not going to get into it because it's all news, but have you seen any Elimination Chamber?
Jenny and I watched Elimination Chamber, and we enjoyed it immensely. It was excellent.
Yeah, I never thought that Zane was going to win, but boy, what a good performance that he put up there. And plus, he had all the loving for Friday Night SmackDown, the Sunday show, and the Monday show, which we're usually not on. And they couldn't have played that better. I knew he was going to lose, you know, but. They made it to a pretty good match. I mean, everybody thought he was going to win, you know, and then, of course, at the end, you know, he just put him away like he always does.
By the way...
But, of course, the Usos helped out, too, of course.
By the way, I did find some cowbell for JFed. And and I'd like to we'll do a little live mix here, Easy. I'm going to be DJ Matt for a second. Let's mix cowbell in with some horn and see how this goes.
This is free to use in your videos.
What do you think?
Not that good.
I'm going to submit that to DJ Midas and see if he'll include it on Late Night Delight.
The Usos, I know Roman Reigns said, you stay in the United States, so when he says that, then you know they got to show up. When he tells them, you stay home, you know, don't interfere in the match, you know they're going to interfere. But I it was great when Kevin Owens came out to the ring and he smashed some people, and then, of course, he came out last Monday night, and you just know those two are going to get together and fight the Usos at WrestleMania. They're all, you know, they're getting their paper. I mean, getting all their stories online, you know, for the big event.
That seems like
those guys are longtime friends. You know, they just pretend they hate each other on the show, but they really like each other when the lights go off.
They really like each other when the lights go off. I don't think it's that kind of show.
They play, you know, on the TV. You know, they hate each other. You know, I'm sure they like each other. Sometimes they do hate each other, but I don't think they do. We've known each other for 20 years. And that'd be a great matchup. When you think Kevin Owens and the Zayn there and against the Usos for the tag team championship.
That will be a good match. I agree.
Yeah, but I'll leave it this way. One good match is not going to. One match is going to be a stupid match. Is MVP is got that real tall dude. You know, Almas. He's going to fight the. I'm doing a bad report here. He's going to fight the. Oh my God. He's used to be MVP's guy there. Help me here. I'm really losing it.
You're losing
it. Bob Lashley. They're going to fight that game. That's going to be a stupid match. As you well know, that guy's been on the air for a while because he can't do anything in the ring. All he does is, that Hamas guy, you need to get rid of him.
Who?
Hamas. He's like 7 feet tall.
Almost.
Yeah, he's awful. He can't talk on the mic at all. You fight Bobby Lashley. They've already done that before. It's just a waste of time. It's like a filler match. I mean, a smash match. But, what was I going to say? They're bringing back in a couple of weeks, and they're playing at the bar, Boston Garden there. You're not going to believe this. They're bringing back John Cena again. So, oh, no, him again? His time is up. You know what they're going to do? They're going to have him face against the, I like this guy. He's intercontinental. He's U.S. champion there. I'm really full fluttering here. The young kid who used to be Vince McMahon, well, he's probably still his favorite. I can't remember his name, but they're pushing him to be the. That's great because they need more young guys to be pushed because, as you all know, the old farts can't do it no more.
Oh, so that's why they call it a cowbell. I get it now.
Flustering on this report, but I tried these people's names down before I talk about them.
By the way,
I'm going to let you go now because on this report, this wasn't one of my best.
All right, easy. Well, thank you for your effort.
Like they say on the guys on the television show, there, we'll try to do better the next time. So I was one of my better ones.
All right, bye, Easy. All right, our friend Easy G, Eric Gagnon, and should we play him out? He kind of bailed out early. He was like, he's kind of like Sarah Palin resigning during her first term as governor. Let's see. We'll play him out.
From around the way, Easy.
You want to know about stock market crashes, COVID-19, drive-bys, celebrity gossip? Easy G's gotcha. Entertainment Report style.
That's why I'm easy.
Cause ain't nothing but a G thing, baby.
Are you ready for start time?
Let's find out. Ready, set, go.
Very nice. By the way, Jason Feddersen in the chat says, can we dedicate horns to people? Like if I said, hey, Matt, play a horn for my lovely wife, Melanie La Liberty, would you do that? I absolutely, absolutely. Here, this is, what's going on there? Let's see here. We'll do that. I'll tell you what, though. Let's give her a little bit of a different, we'll go with this one. Give her a little bit of a special horn for this is for Melanie from Jason. Here we go. Oh, it kind of sounded like the same one, didn't it? All right, I thought that one was going to be different. Well, anyway, there you go. All right, well, that was our friend Easy G, Eric Gagnon. That does open up the line for you. 603-250-6007. 603-250-6007. You can also text us at 617-917-4476. I'm on social media at Matt Connerton. You can email me, matt@mattconnerton.com. And, of course, you can interact and opine in the Facebook live chat, and we'll say hello to everybody in there in just a moment. But the best thing to do so that we can hear and enjoy your dulcet tones is to give us a call at 603-250-6007. We do have some folks in the Facebook live chat. We'll say hello to everybody in there. Jenny, of course, is in the chat room and says, shalom, peeps. We mentioned JFED joins us, of course. And Melanie La Liberty is also in the chat room. Dari Nordine, I'm not sure if I'm saying that correctly, and I apologize if I butchered your name, but thank you for joining us in the chat. Tomorrow, People 5, who I strongly suspect is from Greensboro, North Carolina, says, "Hello, hashtag Matt. We say good afternoon. Hi, hashtag Jenny Coffee. Good afternoon, we said." Let's see. JFED says, "I hate Bruce." Oh, don't we all? Tomorrow, People 5 says, "We don't know that guy, Bruce." Oh, you don't want to. Let me tell you something. That Bruce guy is nothing but trouble. And ideally, I'd like to have Easy have a little talk with him and tell him, "Hey, can you back off a little bit? You're freaking out, Matt Connerton. He's getting very nervous." Let's see. Who else do we have in here? Tomorrow People 5 says, "We say hashtag Matt. We said you had a guest yesterday, and they are the best band ever. We say welcome back from us, Matt." Yes, yesterday on the show. Well, we had a wonderful show yesterday. Jenny was here with us at the news desk, and during the first hour, we were joined by Kenny, owner and proprietor of The Hop Knot, our amazing sponsor, and we had a very interesting discussion. And then in the second hour, we were joined by the band that Tomorrow People 5 is referring to. We had Authentic Dissent in studio with us, and really enjoyed speaking with them. And I'm sure we'll have them back in the future. Tomorrow People 5 says, "We are going to be performing as we can. Surely that we just hope this COVID will be over," we said, hashtag Matt. "We will land at Sawmill 2 Karaoke Night in Greensboro, North Carolina at Market Street, hashtag Matt and hashtag Jenny." Well, very nice. Well, COVID will never be over, unfortunately. We're stuck with it for the rest of our lives, I do believe, as we've discussed on the show, but hopefully it will continue to become more and more manageable over time. Let's see. Tom Blanchard joins us in the Facebook live chat. Hi, Tom. JFED says, "I have a feeling we will hear horns and cowbells and whistles Friday night." Ah, interesting. We shall see. I assume you're referring to Retro Spectrum Radio with Paulie C every Friday night from 8 to 11 p.m. right here from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM. I had to miss last Friday's show. I had a dry hacking cough, which is not what you would call suitable for radio, but I am back. I am back. Let's see. Tomorrow People 5 also says, we will be performing until April at Center City Park at downtown Greensboro, North Carolina. Oh, all right. Paulie C says, "I want to see Dick Van Dyke and Bob Barker beat the S out of each other." That would be a main event in any arena in America, I think. Are they both still alive? Oh, I wonder. I know how to tell without even looking it up, because right here in studio, my friends, is a copy of the celebrity death pool for the morning show. Let's see. Okay, Bob Barker is in the death pool, so he must still be alive. Jeff Nyan has Bob Barker. Who's it? Oh, Dick Van Dyke. Oh, and Dick Van Dyke is also in the... Oh, Paulie C has Dick Van Dyke. So Paulie C has a dog in the fight, so to speak, which is a terrible expression, and I regret using it. Because if Dick Van Dyke and Bob Barker were to fight, Paul would want Bob Barker to win so that Dick Van Dyke would... well, then Paul would win in the death pool because he has Dick Van Dyke. Sorry, I was just scanning through some of the other names on that list. Let's see. So there you go. There you go. Let's see. Who else do we have in here? Chris Rose from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts joins us. Hi, Chris. Tomorrow People 5 says, "We love to hear that horn as well, hashtag Matt." Stephen Light, better known as DJ Steve, joins us in the Facebook live chat, as he joins us every Friday night on Retro Spectrum Radio. Actually, I think Steve does double duty on Fridays. He does both the morning show with Peter White and then is back for Retro Spectrum Radio with Paulie C. Yes, Paul confirms Dick Van Dyke and Bob Barker are both alive. Okay. Very good. Very good. 603-250-6007 is the studio line. 603-250-6007. If you would like to join us on the show today, we have, there's several things, by the way, I did open today's show if you missed it, I played about the last 5 minutes or so of President Biden's speech in Warsaw, Poland, actually dueling speeches. We're not going to get into this in detail now. We'll probably come back to it later in the show. But just if you did hear the opener, I wanted to play part of it. And I what I appreciated about, and, you know, this was obvious that he would do that, is, you know, he really kind of gave Poland a lot of credit for taking in refugees who have been spilling, who had been at least spilling over the border from Ukraine into Poland. I've said many times on the show, and it was, you know, it's another opportunity to just bring this up. Poland really has stepped up in a huge way since this war began with Russia's invasion of Ukraine. Now it's been a year. It's a year ago this month. But Poland has done a phenomenal job and has really gone above and beyond, you know, to help. And they've just been remarkable. So, but we might come back to all of that later. Biden gave his speech. Putin gave his speech. That's why I say dueling speeches. The most notable thing I think coming out of Putin's speech is that they are withdrawing or not actually withdrawing from, but they are suspending their participation in the START treaty. The last nuclear arms treaty, the last remaining nuclear arms treaty that the former Soviet Union has with the United States. So that's not good. And it, I believe that expires in 3 years, the treaty itself. So they're suspending their participation in it, which doesn't necessarily mean much beyond what it indicates rhetorically, but it could. But it could. So we hope not. Not good news. But we might come back to all of that. I do have something else that I want to get to first. Tom Blanchard in the chat says, Dick Van Dyke was on the TV show The Masked Singer last night. Oh, okay. I'll be damned. Yeah, I saw Dick Van Dyke within the last couple of years in an interview where he seems, I mean, he's got to be in his 80s, right? Or he might even be 90. But he seems pretty spry. And certainly still all there mentally. And Shannon is on the line. Hi, Shannon.
Hello. It's nice to hear you back and feeling a little better.
Thank you. Thank you. It's nice to be back.
How about that chloroseptic spray? Does that work for you?
I have used chloroseptic spray in the past, but not for a very long time. Now I don't know how much that stuff actually does, to be honest with you, Shannon. I just now I just try to drink a lot of water.
No honey.
No, I don't do honey. I know it's good for your throat, but I don't do it. I can't. Honey actually makes me nauseous.
Does it?
Yeah,
really?
I know it's good for the throat, but once it hits my stomach, I just feel like I want to puke. It's too sweet or something. Honey really bothers me. I can't do it. Jenny's always trying to get me to use honey, you know, if my throat's bothering me, but I can't. I just can't. I'm disgusted by it, to be honest. But it's good advice. I just can't. It's good advice that I can't take.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I figured there's nothing sweet about it, so you might like the chloroseptic. But
the chloroseptic, yeah. I don't know if that actually does. I'm skeptical.
What about salt and water?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well,
old-fashioned, old-school gargling.
I'll tell you what. I do that if I get like a sore throat where you know, the kind where it feels like I have an actual infection. Like a few years ago, I had a tonsil infection and I was doing that. Although that I ended up needing an antibiotic for, that was so severe. But that is good. Gargling with salt and water, hot water and salt is definitely good for the throat. Yes.
Okay, let's check. Matt Juno doesn't like it when I call and ask questions.
I heard that on the morning show. Yes, yes. Well, I think he was...
I would love to challenge him to get rid of his phone for a week except for work and see how he does. But anyway, that's not why I called.
Well, it'd be very difficult to function without a phone.
No, not really.
I think so.
Not one you can only make calls on.
Yeah, but people communicate largely via text now. So
yeah, and the Facebook, and I can hear the memes ka-chinging all up in a row there.
yeah, memes ka-chinging up in a row. Yeah,
I can hear. In other words, the memes are going to be coming in because I called.
Oh, the memes! Yes.
Yeah.
You're memeable.
But yeah, I wanted to call yesterday, but I wasn't 100% sure on the story, and I'm still not. But I think it was two or three weeks ago. I was listening to something on the radio, and it was a drag queen like contest.
Yeah.
I think Texas is where it was.
Okay.
And or maybe not. I could be wrong. But they were saying that like you had said yesterday, and Eric Pilcher said, you know, be yourself or whatever.
Yeah.
They have to get a bill passed by Congress so they can have their stuff and do their thing and have their fun and live their lives. Because of these people who don't want their kids to see it and whatever. That's the gist that I got from what I heard.
Wait, okay, so are you talking about in Texas?
I think it's in Texas.
So what?
I'm not positive, but and when they said that, I thought this was a free country.
Well, there's a big culture war thing now with Republicans like Ron DeSantis in Florida, for example, where it's like, we have to protect children from people dressing in drag because if you let children know that that's a thing, then all of America's children will start to turn gay or become trans or something. It's hard to fathom what these people really what they're so worked up about. But I mean, my personal advice, Shannon, and I'm curious if you agree. I don't have any children myself, but if I did have children and I was concerned about them being exposed to people in drag, I would just not take them to a drag show. And
exactly.
That would be pretty much it. But I also would, Shannon, if my children came to me and asked me about this and said, there's this thing going on. Can you tell me about it? I would probably have a conversation with my kids about it and explain to them. And part of my conversation with my kids might include something like, well, one of the things you'll learn as you grow up is that not everyone in the world is exactly like you. And that's actually okay.
Yes, everybody's different.
Everybody's different. And that's not a bad thing. And some dudes like to dress up in women's clothing, and
and Ron DeSantis probably has a personal account with Fredericks of Hollywood.
Well, I don't know that, but he does seem to. Well, I'll tell you what, Shannon. So I don't know if you know who. You probably don't because you're not really online. But there's a conservative one of the top five most popular. Primarily online conservative commentators, Stephen Crowder, who we've talked about on the show recently because he was offered a $50 million deal to go to the Daily Wire. And but he's known for dressing up in drag. And I think he's very freaked out by people who are different than he is. And yet he dresses up in drag, but I think he tries to present it as though he's doing it ironically and he doesn't really enjoy it when it's pretty obvious that he does and whatnot. But I think everybody needs to lighten up a little bit and not assume the worst about people who are different. You know, it's like it's okay for people to dress in drag. They're not going to harm your children unless you let them.
I mean, they do a lot of work. It takes a lot of work to get to the point that you are up on stage with all the practice and everything you have to do.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
Routines you have to learn. And
absolutely, absolutely. No, it's very impressive. Kenny was saying, what was Kenny saying? It takes him like 3 hours just to do his makeup?
Something like that for 3-4 hours.
Yeah, yeah. But
I couldn't believe the four pairs of nylons.
Yeah, yeah.
That's going to be uncomfortable.
Yeah.
They should figure some. Get a girl or something that isn't, I don't know. Because he was saying that they put couch cushions on because their hips are different.
Right.
So get some kind of a girdle. That way you get a bit of a breeze on your legs, you know?
Right. I wish I'd thought of that. I would have advised him to do that.
Copyright. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
But no, my whole problem with it was, why does Congress have to pass a law? That's the whole point of it. There's a thing around. That was my whole point. It's a free country, so
yeah.
why should we have to pass a law every time we want to do something different because somebody wants to be different? You know?
Yeah.
It's a rhetorical question, but...
Yeah, of course.
Anyway.
Yeah. It's But, you know, these culture war issues, unfortunately, they have a way of really mobilizing people. But, you know, our friend Eric Pilcher, who, as he likes to describe himself, the token conservative Christian who's a part of the show, you know, because he does the classic film reviews. So he is very much a part of the show. You know, he says, you know, everybody's got to live their lives and be who they want to be. And
a world it would be. Okay, listen, people on Facebook. What a world it would be if everybody just accepted people for the way they are.
Yep.
I call in sometimes with five pieces of information to a show I heard, but no, it may not make sense, but it might make somebody go listen to it and find it.
Right.
And, you know, but I'm also learning, I also learn things, you know, if you explain. I'm not a whole political person very much.
Yeah.
But I learn from you.
Thank you.
I've been asking a lot, but where's the freedom in the country? And that sounded a little bit campaigny to me. what you opened up with today.
Oh, what's Biden's speech?
Yeah.
Oh, sure. Well, I mean, he's we're assuming he's running for re-election. Yeah. I mean, every speech is going to sound campaigny.
Well.
But I like the speech. I thought it was a good speech, actually.
Yeah. But no, I do learn things from you, and I appreciate you. Jenny's son?
Yes.
Was on Granite State of Mind, I think?
Yes, Jesse. He was on Granite State of Mind.
I love the version of the song by Foo Fighters.
Oh, what did he play? Oh, he played Everlong. Yes.
Yes.
Yep. Everlong. Yep. Yep, he's very talented. He's going to be on this show. I don't remember the date offhand, but Jenny has him booked to come on here as well. And
March 17th.
Really looking forward to that. March 17th?
I think so. No, I was just a guess.
I was going to say, wow, you're in the know. Good for you.
Yeah, it would be funny if it was. Can I win something if it was? No, I'm just kidding. I just want a hat. I need a baseball hat.
Do you?
Yeah. You know, for when it's rainy and snowy.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like umbrellas. They're too awkward, and a gust comes along, and it goes up inside out. And
Shannon, you might be some kind of psychic. You were not far off. Jenny just posted the date in the chat room. March 20th is when Jesse's coming on. What did you say, the 27th? You were only off by a week. That's pretty good.
Okay, well.
That's pretty good.
Yeah. Okay.
So, there you go.
Well, that's basically all I wanted to say.
All right, Shannon. Well, nice to hear from you.
And was there anything else? No, but did you... You weren't on Radio Spectrum, and Pauly C is in the chat room, right?
Pauly C is in the chat room, yes. Or he was. Yeah, I don't know if he still is.
I said it this morning, and you know, great. That was a great show. I love the old stuff. The old commercials.
Yeah.
And I know it wasn't just about cars, it was all kinds of stuff, but people have gotten lazy. This is how lazy we've gotten. Now there's, T-Mobile, Netflix, AT&T. All these places have a little jingle. But not a jingle, but just beeps, you know what I mean?
Sure.
What is that called? Do you know what I mean? It's not a jingle is like in the old days when they used to sing a song or something.
Yeah.
Now they just have do 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 do.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I know what you mean. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. That's lazy.
Well, you want a full on jingle?
Yeah.
Oh.
I could care less about any of it, but yeah, put some effort into it.
Yeah. I think the day of the jingle is past, Shannon.
But the air horn is still alive. Have a good night.
All right. Bye, Shannon. Thank you for the call. All right. All right. Very nice. The air horn is, well, the air horn has been brought back to life. Yes. Yes. Our friend Kenny from the Hop Knot, he requested the air horn. 603-250-6007 is the studio line if you'd like to join us today. 603-250-6007. Rick Smith is in the chat room and says, speaking of honey, anyone going to watch that horror Winnie the Pooh movie? Oh, I know Melanie is. And I'm sure Jason will be watching it with her. Jason Fetterson, yes. Melanie La Liberty was posting about that. She was very excited. I did not realize until the first time that she posted about that. I was like, how can they do that? But apparently Winnie the Pooh is public domain. So they can you can do with it. You can make your own thing with Winnie the Pooh if you want to. Crystal from the great state of Illinois joins us in the chat room and says, hello, everyone. Hello, Crystal. Tom Blanchard says, like Klinger on MASH. Yes, yes. I was a big MASH fan growing up. And yes, Klinger in early seasons on the television series MASH, Corporal Klinger would dress up. The reason he would dress in drag was because he was trying to pretend that he was crazy so that he would get discharged from the, what do they call that? Oh, I can't remember what they call it on the show, section something. But nobody ever believed him. Well, everyone knew that he was just doing it to pretend like he was crazy, but that he wasn't actually crazy. And then his character evolved, and then when Radar leaves and goes back to the States, Klinger takes over Radar's job, and with the responsibility of Radar's job, Klinger evolves, and he says, "Okay, I'm not gonna dress up anymore. I'm just gonna be me." And I'm going to stop trying to pretend that I'm crazy because I'm actually going to take my responsibility seriously. So, Shannon is calling back. Hi, Shannon.
Section 8.
Is it Section 8?
Yes, I do believe so.
That's what I thought, too. But then I was like, wait a minute. No, Section 8 is public housing.
Yeah, but it's also the other one.
It is. Okay. All right, cool.
Someone can double that on that. Okay.
Okay.
I know a couple things. Bye.
All right, bye, Shannon. Okay, it is Section 8. See, that's what I wanted to say, Section 8, and then I didn't say it because I thought, no, that's housing. Housing is Section 8, but I guess that is true in the military as well. So, anyway, 603-250-6007 is the number, 603-250-6007. And by the way, Tomorrow People 5 in the chat room says, we say, sad news yesterday, actor-comedian Richard Belzer passed away. We said, I did not realize, so I don't know how it got past me yesterday. I did not know that Richard Belzer had passed away until this morning. I was listening to Howard Stern this morning, and he mentioned that Richard Belzer, they were talking about Richard Belzer because he had been a recurring guest 57 times, I think they said. Richard Belzer had appeared on the Howard Stern show over the years, but I had not realized that he had passed away. Rocky Huber joins us in the chat room and says, hashtag hi. Hello, Rocky. Let's see. I want to make sure we discuss this. Today, you know, it is Black History Month, of course. And our friend Eric Pilcher, who does his classic film reviews for us, he's been reviewing films during the month of February that are appropriate for Black History Month. Tomorrow, we're going to be airing his review of the film Juice. And Friday, Spike, a personal favorite of mine, Spike Lee's classic, Do the Right Thing, which is a great film. Today, and Eric was the one who first brought this to my attention, actually, today is the 58th anniversary, 58 years ago today, that Malcolm X was assassinated. Eric did review the film Malcolm X recently on the show, as portrayed by the great Denzel Washington. This is what Eric wrote on social media. On this day, 58 years ago, Malcolm X was assassinated at the Audubon Ballroom right before giving a speech. His views were controversial until he took the required, and I'm not sure how to pronounce this, H-A-D-J, Hodge, to Mecca. While there, he saw all races worshiping together. That, along with hypocrisy being committed by the Nation of Islam leader Elijah Muhammad, he had fathered many illegitimate children and underage girls, also allegedly, and likely Muhammad influenced the gunman to commit the act against Malcolm. This hypocrisy that Malcolm X saw caused him to leave the Nation of Islam and forge ahead and start his own Islamic sect. preaching equality for all. You won't hear him spoken about in the same vein as Rosa Parks or Martin Luther King. School history books have struck him from the times of remembrance. But this journey of redemption was lifelong, and one we can all learn from. I personally will always mention him at the forefront of the civil rights fight. In honor of this day, I share my review of Malcolm X, and Eric did share this out on social media. He shared his review of Malcolm X. This review is the longest I've done, the one I'm proudest of, and the one I wish could have been longer, because that is what this fallen soldier and brave warrior deserves. Yes. So, 58 years ago today, Malcolm X was assassinated. I have something here from ANENews.com. And then there's something else with this too. There's a lawsuit. Well, we'll get to that in a second, but it gets particularly interesting. So let's look at this first. So U.S. marks 58th anniversary of assassination of civil rights icon Malcolm X. It says here, U.S. civil rights leader Malcolm X was assassinated 58 years ago, but his legacy lives on, especially in the black community. Quote, Malcolm X is equally important to the civil rights movement as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., unquote, said Derek Handley, an assistant professor of English at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee and an affiliated faculty with the Departments of African and African Diaspora Studies and Urban Studies program. Quote, Malcolm X was the primary figure that the Black Power movement held in high regard, unquote. By the way, you won't hear any of this discussion in schools in the state of Florida, if I'm not mistaken. Just as a side note, so any young folks listening from Florida, sorry if this is new to you, but your governor doesn't want you to hear any of this. It says here, Malik El Shabazz, who adopted the name Malcolm X to symbolize his unknown African ancestral surname, preached black empowerment at a time in American history when society was dominated by whites. Handley told Anadulo during a phone interview that many of Malcolm X's followers viewed his teachings like their Bible, embracing his philosophies, which had not been seen before in America. Handley said, quote, a lot of black people didn't hear anyone talk about black and white people like Malcolm did. He was viewed as being fearless. The way that Malcolm talked, he appealed to young black men. He was the symbol of black manhood in that I'm not afraid of anybody. I'm not afraid of any white person. Not only am I not your equal, but I might be more superior than you. That was a whole new way of thinking, unquote. Malcolm X professed that type of rhetoric in many of his speeches during the 1960s civil rights movement, which made him a lightning rod for criticism. He said in a speech on April 3rd, 1964, quote, we're all in the same boat and we all are going to catch the same hell from the same man. He just happens to be white. All of us have suffered here in this country, political oppression at the hands of the white man, economic exploitation at the hands of the white man, and social degradation at the hands of the white man, unquote. While Handley and Malcolm X spoke candidly about the differentiation between blacks and whites, when it came to discrimination and social injustices, he explained that Malcolm X's rhetoric was often misinterpreted as being violent, which he said is a misnomer. Quote, the history and the media painted the narrative of Malcolm X promoting violence. When it wasn't violence he was promoting, it was self-defense. He wasn't calling for violent protests. Malcolm X was saying that if someone hits you on the head with a stick, you have the right to defend yourself, unquote. Handley pointed out that both Malcolm X and Martin Luther King are civil rights figures whose philosophies usually get painted with one stroke of a brush. Handley said, quote, folks want to freeze MLK in time, always pointing to his I Have a Dream speech. In the same way, they freeze Malcolm X in time when he, with the Nation of Islam, I'm sorry, when he was with the Nation of Islam and promoted self-defense while pointing out the injustices being faced by blacks at the hands of whites, they get frozen in time. Martin was nonviolent. Malcolm was violent, unquote. Malcolm X rose to fame in the 50s with his meteoric ascent to power as a member of the Nation of Islam. He increasingly took center stage over the group's leader, Elijah Muhammad, and professed a flexed muscle approach to the civil rights movement, which significantly contrasted with the peaceful philosophy of MLK, leading the public to portray Malcolm X as a militant leader. Handley said, quote, when you compare the two, MLK was more acceptable to the moderate white population than Malcolm X. They looked at Malcolm's followers and painted them as the black Muslims. with a narrative of being violent and calling his followers the real racists because they were the people who really hated others. And for many white people, seeing that was scary, unquote. On February 21, 1965, Malcolm X was assassinated as he began a speech at the Audubon Ballroom in New York City. Three black men were arrested for Malcolm X's assassination. Two of them were not even at the shooting scene that day. Now, this is where it gets interesting. The Manhattan District Attorney's Office in New York reopened the case, and both wrongly convicted men were exonerated and had their sentences vacated in November 2021. Over the nearly six decades since the assassination, Handley said that the narrative of Malcolm X's civil rights philosophies has changed in regard to how the public views him, in part because society eventually saw the ways in which both MLK and Malcolm X influenced each other. Quote, Malcolm embraced some of Martin's philosophies when it came to blacks and whites getting along. He wasn't talking about holding hands, but if you're a sincere white person, we can work together. In the same way, MLK embraced some of Malcolm X's views, while MLK saying in his later years before his assassination that he was proud to be black and that he embraced black power and black empowerment, unquote. As with MLK, Handley said Malcolm X's motive was clear and that he tried to bring about equality and justice to the black community. A little bit more here, and then we'll get to the lawsuit that was just filed. Quote, Malcolm embraced some of... Here we go. Quote, and again, this is Handley again. Quote, the legacy of Malcolm X today is if you're somebody, you have pride, you have this notion of black economic power. He influenced the Black Power movement, the Black Arts movement, the Black Student movement, the Black Studies programs and departments being created across the nation's colleges. That's Malcolm X's legacy. That black history is actually being taught in schools is because of Malcolm X, unquote. Now, there is a little bit more to that, but we're running late. Let's look at this. And this just happened. This is from Daily Mail. Malcolm X's daughters are set to sue the New York City Police Department and other city agencies for concealing evidence around their father's murder. Civil rights lawyer Ben Crump to defend family on 58th anniversary of Malcolm X's death. Some points from the article here. It says the daughters of Malcolm X plan to file a lawsuit against NYPD and several government agencies. There have long been allegations that the government agencies such as the FBI and the NYPD were involved in the assassination of Malcolm X. Lawyer Ben Crump intends to file a notice of intent to sue on behalf of Malcolm X's daughters, and evidence related to his murder was hidden by authorities. Let's look at the main story here. It's not too long, and then we'll get to a break. But it says here, so the three remaining daughters, again, this is from the Daily Mail. The three remaining daughters of Malcolm X are planning to sue the NYPD. Alicia, 60, Atala, 64, and Quibilla, I don't know if I'm saying that correctly, Shabazz, 62, are to allege how evidence related to Malcolm X's murder in 1965 was fraudulently concealed by authorities. Their case has been picked up by renowned civil rights and personal injury attorney Ben Crump, with whom they have enjoyed a long partnership. Crump, together with co-counsel Ray Hamlin, is planning to file a notice of intent and sue the NYPD together with various government agencies on behalf of the daughters, alleging their involvement in the assassination. The suit will allege how evidence relating to Malcolm X's murder was fraudulently concealed by authorities. The role played by federal and New York government agencies such as NYPD, FBI, and CIA in his murder has been a matter of dispute for a long time. Today marks the 58th anniversary of civil rights leader Malcolm X's death. On that day in 1965, while speaking at the Audubon Ballroom, Malcolm X was assassinated at the age of 39, in front of his family, having been shot 21 times by several men. At the time, the agencies had access to factual and exculpatory evidence that Crump alleges they kept from Malcolm X's family and the individuals wrongly convicted of crimes connected to his assassination. Then it gets into some of Malcolm X's history here. I'm going to skip down, though. I want to get to... Okay. The night of the murder. So, on February 21st, 1965, Malcolm X was given a speech at the Audubon Ballroom in Upper Manhattan when he was shot and killed by multiple gunmen. Three men were later convicted for their roles in the assassination, but many have raised questions about who else might have been involved in the plot and what their motivations were. Muhammad Aziz and Khalil Islam, then known as Norman 3X Butler and Thomas 15X Johnson, and a third man, were convicted of murder in March 1966. They were sentenced to life in prison. The third man, Mahid Abdul Halim, admitted to shooting Malcolm X, but said neither Aziz nor Islam was involved. The two offered alibis and no physical evidence linked them to the crime. In 2021, their judgments were overturned, with Aziz, now 85, and the family of the late Islam, who died in 2018, awarded a collective $36 million after the pair both spent decades in prison for their alleged part in the 1965 killing. Following a nearly two-year investigation by their lawyers and the Manhattan DA, both men were exonerated in November 2021 after a series of doubts by historians and legal experts over inconsistencies in the case saw their conviction overturned. By the way, just a quick side note, again, this is why I oppose the death penalty, because sometimes we convict people who aren't guilty. Okay, to make good on the monumental slight, the New York officials agreed to pay $26 million for the wrongful convictions, with the state forking over an additional $10 million. The decision to make good on the wrongful convictions came after a 22-month investigation and allegations that prosecutors, the FBI, and New York police withheld crucial evidence in the case that would have acquitted the pair. There have also been allegations that government agencies such as the FBI and the NYPD were involved in the assassination. Some believe that Malcolm X's activism and criticism of these agencies may have made him a legal target for retaliation. I don't doubt that. He had also become more vocal about his opposition to racism and oppression in all forms, which may have made him a target of those who disagreed with his message. After Netflix aired the documentary series Who Killed Malcolm X in early 2020, the Manhattan DA's office announced it was taking a fresh look at the case. Then Mayor Bill de Blasio said at the time, quote, "For millions and millions of Americans, we still need to know who killed Malcolm X and who ordered it," unquote. But the prospect is clouded by the passage of time. Every eyewitness who testified at the trial has died, and all of the physical evidence, including a shotgun used in the killing, is gone, as are any phone records that might have existed. It goes on from there, but it's a long article, but, so this is still an open question. So I wanted to look at that. I thought that was interesting. Jenny had brought that to my attention earlier, that Ben Crump was, suing on behalf of Malcolm X's daughters. And, that was announced, I think, just yesterday, actually. All right, let's do this. We are past the top of the hour. I'm going to play... Ooh, should we play this? Yeah, let's... we had a band here yesterday in our second hour. Authentic Dissent. And we played several of their songs, but this particular one is my favorite. So I want to play this. Yesterday I opened the show with it, but I want to play it for the break today. It's called The Weight of the World. And I really like this track a lot. Let's give this a listen, and then we'll show some love to our amazing sponsors. And then we'll be back with the balance of our program today. More Matt Connerton Unleashed coming up. Don't go anywhere. Here's Weight of the World by Authentic Dissent.
Come on down to the Hop Knot at 1000 Elm Street, Manchester's premier craft beer and gourmet pretzel bar. Tell us more, Trudy.
We make our dough fresh every day. We make a variety of styles of pretzels and serve craft beer, cocktails, and a few bottles of wine. We do the traditional pretzel, and we have multiple flavors for that. We also do stuffed pretzels, pretzel sandwiches, free dessert pretzels, and pretzel knots.
The Hop Knot in the Brady Sullivan Plaza at 1000 Elm Street.
Bring your kitchen to life with Queen City Cabinetry, located at 87 Elm Street in the historic Sunbeam Mall in Manchester. Open Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Saturdays, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. They can be reached at 603-222-2007 or on the web at queencitycabinetrynh.com. Come see the possibilities. Queen City Cabinetry, another proud sponsor of WMNH.
Clemento's Pizzeria, family friendly, awesome for a date night. Clemento's Pizzeria.
For delivery, call 603-782-8450.
Clemento's Pizzeria, the best pizza in town.
1875 South Willow Street in Manchester, New Hampshire.
Best cocktails around.
Come in as friends and leave as family.
This hour on WMNH is sponsored by CGI Business Solutions, located at 5 Dartmouth Drive in Auburn. They serve all your business needs, including employee benefits planning, corporate design and business administration, investments and wealth management, and customized business insurance solutions. Their phone number is 866-841-4600 or on the web at cgibusinesssolutions.com.
WMNH, rip the knob off. Hey!
Welcome back, everybody. We are well in hour number two, numero dos of Matt Connerton Unleashed. And we are live from the studios of WMNH 95.3 FM in glorious downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. Also on Comcast 97 if you're in Manchester. And hello to all of our online listeners across the nation and around the globe. You can go to my website, mattconnerton.com. For all of your live streaming options, social media links, contact info, show archives, etc., etc. Today is Tuesday, February 21, 2023, and it is the 58th anniversary of the assassination of Malcolm X. If you're just joining us, we were getting into that during the first hour. We're going to move on to some other things, but as we continue through Black History Month, tomorrow on the show, for Eric Pilcher's classic film review, we're going to have his review of the film Juice, which we were supposed to run Friday, but I wasn't here. So we're going to run that tomorrow. And then we were supposed to do it today, but we're going to hold it for tomorrow because tomorrow Eric will be available to be in the chat room to respond to feedback and questions and whatnot while the review airs. So I said, yeah, we'll hold that until Wednesday. And then Friday, for Eric's classic film review to cap off Black History Month. It is the Spike Lee film, Do the Right Thing. And I'm really looking forward to Friday's review. That was, I remember seeing that when it came out. Yeah, such a great movie. That's a favorite of mine. So looking forward to that. Yesterday on the show, by the way, so we also had Kenny from the Hop Knot, our amazing sponsor at 1000 Elm Street. Don't go there today. Monday and Tuesday is their weekend, but they are open Wednesday through Sunday. And it's always nice. So we've got to get Kenny. We did get him to commit. We got him to commit live on the air to coming in a little more often instead of, letting 6 months or 8 months or however long go by between appearances. I think he's very good on the radio, and we always have a really interesting discussion. And, and we talked about some racial issues and some other issues, too, with Kenny. The Hop Knot is a Black-owned business, so... excuse me, I had to hit the button there for a second. I'm still, I was terribly ill last week and had quite the dry hacking cough, and I've still got a little bit going on there in the throat. So sorry if you hear an unusually long and awkward pause. It's because I had to hit the mute button for a moment while I hack all over myself. Almost there, though. It's definitely at the tail end. I mean, I feel fine physically otherwise. It's just all in my throat at this point. So we had Kenny here. That was a great discussion. And then in the second hour, we had the band Authentic Descent. And I love that song, Weight of the World, that I played going into the break. That was my favorite of the songs that they sent us to play during the interview. And but I kept trying to figure out, there was another song that song Weight of the World reminded me of, and it finally came to me. I solved the mystery listening to it that time. I realized what it was. Rat has a song. I forget which album it's on. It's from their it's from one of their 90s albums. It was after the peak when they were not really that big anymore, but still maintained a following. They had a song called Dead Reckoning. And I realized that's what that song reminds me of. It reminds me of Dead Reckoning by Rat. Not that it's a copying it or anything like that. No, not at all. That's not what I mean. But it just kind of... oh, boy, I'm coughing a lot here. But just in terms of the verses are a little bit similar. But I love Dead Reckoning by Rat, too, so it makes sense that I would like that song. No, but those guys were great. We do have a musical guest tomorrow on the show, too, by the way, Time Wolf. I believe they're Skyping in. If I'm not mistaken, I think they're from Boston. And be great if they could make the trip up and be with us live in studio. But anyone from this area knows. Boston to here on a Friday afternoon, little dicey. Little dicey. You're going to be sitting in some traffic. So 93 North, they are on Friday. Isn't that what I said, Jenny? Didn't I say Friday? Maybe I didn't. I thought I said Friday. They're going to... So I think they're Skyping in because, 93 North heading from Boston. I'll tell you what, when I, years ago... Oh, Jenny says you just said tomorrow. Oh, okay. I meant Friday. Yes, Friday. Time Wolf joins us. When I was in college and I was doing an internship at a place in Boston called Powderfinger Promotions, and somebody outside on Elm Street is yelling very loudly. Oh, it's probably that Bruce guy again. Anyway. My ongoing feud with Bruce. Bruce! That didn't feel good on my throat. I shouldn't do that. When I did my internship at Powderfinger, which was... they're not in Boston anymore. Now I think they're in Framingham now. But I would... a couple days a week, I would have to go there. And they were really good about... They would try to get me out of there. I was living... I wasn't even in Manchester. I was even further north. I was living in Concord at the time. And they would try to get me out of there by 3:30 at the latest, because they knew, they understood that if I wasn't in my car and headed toward getting on 93 North by you know, by 3:45 at the very latest, because it would take me a little bit. I'd have to park kind of far away from the offices. And they knew that if I wasn't out the door by 3:30 and to my car by 3:45 and headed north, that I might as well just stay until like 6 p.m. or 6:30, because the traffic would be so bad, especially on a Friday, all the commuters. And sometimes they actually did let me, there were times when it was hard to get me out of there because they just had a lot for me to do. But they were cool. Even though I was just an intern, they trusted me. They gave me a key and they let me stay and work late and hang out even after they all left, so, which was nice. And I just enjoyed being there too, you know. That was one of my early entrances into the music industry. And I learned a lot there too. Powderfinger Promotions. Dave Avery, great guy, great man. 603-250-6007 is the studio line. 603-250-6007 if you'd like to join us. You can also text us at 617-917-4476. I'm on social media at Matt Connerton. You can email me, matt@mattconnerton.com. And of course, you can interact and opine in the Facebook live chat. But the best thing to do so that we can hear and enjoy your dulcet tones is to give us a call at 603-250-6007. By the way, Rocky Huber says in the chat room, we say from us to you, from me, we say #TomorrowPeople5. Hi, I love #PopSingingGroups. Very nice. Rocky making some friends with our friends from Greensboro, North Carolina. Melanie Law Liberty says, I'm super excited to see it. Oh, the Winnie the Pooh horror movie that's coming out. Pooh makes friends with the help of a sledgehammer. Wow, that does sound like something. let's see. I want to get to this because this is something we talk about a lot on the show, and I know also too. You know, I mentioned earlier that Biden gave his speech in Poland, and Putin has given his speech and some dueling speeches. But and maybe we'll get to that today if we have time. But this the Supreme Court is right now hearing a case about Section 230. And Section 230 is something that we've talked about a lot on the show. And if this story, you know, I don't know if this is on anyone's top five list of news stories today that they're paying attention to, but this is really important. Because depending on how the Supreme Court rules on this case, it could really change the nature of how so much of the internet works for all of us. And what Section 230, the short version, what it effectively does is, and by the way, in the 2020 election, both presidential candidates, both President Trump and President Biden, who then was not yet President Biden, they both supported repealing Section 230 for different reasons, but they both wanted to get rid of it. And frankly, I think they were both terribly wrong on the subject. Effectively, Section 230 shields social media companies from being held liable for what their users post on their platforms. So in theory, if Section 230 were to go away, and again, this is a little bit reductive, but this is, you know, look, I'm not an attorney or a legal expert of any kind. And I know many of you are going, yeah, we noticed, Matt. But so this is just kind of my surface level understanding of it. But if Section 230 were to go away, then that would really open it up for these companies to be held liable, like Facebook and Instagram. Well, of course, Instagram is owned by Facebook. I should just say Meta, you know, and YouTube and so forth. The different social media companies could be held liable for the content that users post. And if they're held liable, if they can be held liable, that opens them up to lawsuits from people who are upset with something about their content. Then that could be, as some have predicted, that could be the end of social media. So this has, this really, you know, I mean, social media is so ingrained in our lives. It's such an important part of our lives now in terms of how people communicate, how people express themselves. And frankly, you know, how we do things like, well, here's an example, how we promote and distribute this radio show. And connect with listeners, you know, just as an example. And I have other business interests that are very dependent on social media and how the internet operates and what people are allowed to do online and so on and so forth. So, you know, I have a stake in this, but we all have a stake in it to some degree. Those of us who are doing business online, you know, we might have a little bit of a larger stake, but even if you're, you know, if you're a content creator, you have a stake in this. This really could change everything if Section 230 goes away. Jenny says that's like monitoring a restaurant and penalizing unacceptable speech. Yeah. Well, you know what it kind of reminds me of too, a little bit, is if you're going to start holding these social media companies, responsible. It's like people who advocate for being able to sue gun manufacturers, which I think is even Bernie Sanders. Now, I don't know what his position is on it now, but the one thing that as liberal as Bernie Sanders is, obviously, the one thing he has spoken out against where he has not taken the liberal position is he has in the past opposed making it easy for people to sue gun manufacturers, because he said if you do that, if you allow for that, it will be the end of gun manufacturing in the United States. Which, by the way, some people might like that. Now, personally, I'm very pro Second Amendment. That's an issue where I tend to be more conservative. you know, personal responsibility has to play some sort of a role in things. I mean, it's like, you know, how many people are killed in by the negligence of others in car accidents every year? So are we going to make it so you can sue auto manufacturers now? So, you know, we have to think and look as a consequentialist. I'm very worried about what happens here if Section 230 liability protections are repealed. So this is from, I was trying to find the most recent update because this is an ongoing course. So this is an ongoing case, rather, active in the court right now in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court is going to rule on this. So computerworld.com has an article up. Section 230 liability. This one up today. Liability protections on trial in Google Supreme Court case. Whether Google can be held liable for recommending harmful content on YouTube is at the heart of a watershed case that could shape the future of the internet. By the way, that's not just, you know, that sounds hyperbolic, but this really could have, I mean, this could really change everything. It says here, the U.S. Supreme Court today heard oral arguments from lawyers representing Google, the Department of Justice, and the family of a 23-year-old woman killed in Paris by terrorists in 2015. The case, Gonzalez versus Google, represents a crucial legal landmark in how the U.S. legal justice system holds large technology platforms like Google responsible for the content they host. The family of Noemi Gonzalez argues that Google acted as a recruiting platform for the Islamic State group, which the U.S. Department the U.S. State Department describes as a terrorist organization. By recommending Islamic State-related videos on YouTube, Google violated U.S. laws against providing aid to terrorist groups, the family argues. Google, however, has argued that it is legally immune from such suits thanks to Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, which prevents internet-based companies from liability for user-generated content. So you're with me so far, right? Now, I have to tell you, again, it's, you know, you want to try to suppress harmful content where you can, but you can't, these companies can't catch everything. And by the way, when you try to catch everything, you end up catching some things that aren't actually harmful content. Listen, we've talked about it on the show many times. I've brought this up so many times. Regular listeners are probably sick of hearing me mention it, but sometimes, you know, like I'll put something on YouTube and I'll get dinged for breaking a rule that I didn't actually break, but the bots that listen to the content, they think I said something I didn't say when maybe I was quoting somebody else or whatever it is. So, you know, it's not perfect, but if you want these things to function, you know, you want Google to work where you can type something in and search for something and find the information, right? That's how it works. That's what you want it to do. And you want it to, you know, everybody complains about the algorithms. Oh, the algorithm's this, the algorithm's that. People get trapped in their ideological bubbles because they're constantly being served content that only reinforces their existing positions and biases and ideologies, right? Which is true. That is what happens. But again, that goes back to personal responsibility. So if that's what's happening to you, you have to have enough self-awareness, and I realize the average person does not, but you have to have enough self-awareness to realize, boy, I should probably start going out of my way to expose myself to some opinions and content that disagrees and challenges with what I already think. Otherwise, I'm just in an ideological bubble. Which most people are. Most people exist in an ideological bubble. They've made up their minds what they believe, and anything that you know, that doesn't comport with that, they put their hands over their ears and they go, no, I can't hear you. No. Right? But here's the thing. What's the solution? Do you want these algorithms to not work and not suggest content for you? Of course not. So you have to take the responsibility upon yourself to break out of that bubble if you want to. Most people don't want to. Fine. Whatever. Can't help you. Right? But this technology has to work the way that it works, or it's not going to be particularly useful to you. I mean, Google is the simplest, easiest example, right? If you're going to go to Google and you're going to look something up, you want Google to generate results for whatever it is you type in. So if you type in something that ultimately is going to cause some harm, well, that's not Google's fault. Google is working exactly how it's supposed to. But if you're typing in something that is going to cause harm because the results that you get from Google when you type in whatever that thing is give you bad ideas about going and doing harm, that's on you. That's not on Google. That's not Google's fault. If you go on YouTube and you watch a video that gives you a very bad idea and you go and act on that very bad idea that you saw in that YouTube video, that's on you. That's not YouTube's fault. So you either want this stuff to work or you don't. But the scapegoating of big tech is beyond absurd. And it's dangerous because you're going to end up wrecking this whole thing. Okay, people have to take personal responsibility. And I'm so sorry about, by the way, what happened to this woman who was a victim of these terrorists. Please don't anyone misunderstand me on that. I'm so sorry. That's horrible. Of course. And I blame the terrorists for that. And I blame their ideology for it. I'm not going to sit here and blame Google for it. That's nuts. That's absurd. Okay, back to this. Again, this is from computerworld.com. The hearing was a contentious one, with the assembled justices peppering the lawyers for each party with questions. Google's lawyer, Lisa Blatt, argued strenuously that algorithmically generated recommendations for content are covered by Section 230, and that the legal immunity provided by that law is a fundamental building block of the modern internet. Without Section 230, Blatt said, every content-driven platform on the internet, from Yelp to Zillow to Amazon, would be liable for each and every piece of content they host. Right, exactly. Which, by the way, that's what some people want. But it's untenable. Okay, Google says eliminating liability protections threatens the internet. Blatt said, quote, exposing websites to liability for implicitly recommending third-party context defies the text of Section 230. I think that's supposed to be third-party content. There's a typo here. Exposing websites to liability for implicitly recommending third-party content defies the text of Section 230 and threatens today's internet, unquote. The thrust of Google defense was echoed and backed up by multiple briefs filed to the Supreme Court by big tech companies, including Microsoft, Twitter, and Facebook parent company Meta. The lawyer for the Gonzalez family, University of Washington law professor Eric Schnapper, I think that's how you say it. That's kind of fun. Schnapper argued that the recommendations provided by platforms like YouTube are essentially editorial choices. Those platforms could have been designed such that they don't surface or recommend harmful or defamatory content, but they were not. The decision to let YouTube recommend that harmful content, therefore, is one that the platform providers made consciously, which means that they should be held accountable for its publication. Okay, BS. Listen, I'm sorry if I sound naive when I say this, but I don't think that anybody working in big tech is sitting there going, listen, we have to design this software so that these algorithms specifically target people with harmful content. We need to make sure that the most harmful of content is listed first. We got to push the harmful stuff. You know, it shouldn't have anything to do with, you know, whatever they're searching for. We need to make sure that we harm the users somehow by pushing this nonsense. Come on. Schnapper said, quote, "In some circumstances, the manner in which third-party content is organized or presented could convey other information from the defendant itself," unquote, underscoring the point that the ability to provide recommendations is not necessarily neutral. Why would it be neutral? The idea is, you know, if I, to refer back to something we discussed briefly in the first hour, you know, if I'm going on YouTube and I'm looking up Steven Crowder in drag, I don't want neutral items about Steven Crowder popping up. I want items about Steven Crowder in drag. Anyway. Crystal says in the chat room, "With the Google case, depending how that goes, would affect January 6th, too. Hasn't it been claimed Q used Facebook, Twitter, and especially Parler to spread misinformation and meet to conspire, etc.?" Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And you all know how I feel about January 6th. I feel that it was an insurrection, and I believe the people who entered the Capitol that day are domestic terrorists. But I don't blame social media for that. Social media obviously makes it easier for that misinformation to spread and then people to believe it. The unprecedented preponderance of conspiracy theories and the people who buy into them in our society is directly driven by social media. That's one of the downsides of social media. Social media does have some downsides. Like anything, you know, it's I think social media is a great thing, but it can be used for nefarious purposes. But that doesn't mean, you know, I mean, cars can be used for nefarious purposes. You could run somebody over on a crosswalk because you're looking down at your phone texting, right? Doesn't mean we get rid of cars, you know. But yeah, I mean, that would, you're right, Crystal. I mean, that would affect. That would affect January 6th cases, these individual cases of people being tried. I can see that, definitely. Twitter liability case also goes before the Supreme Court. So in the Gonzalez case, as well as the closely related matter of Twitter versus Tomna, I'm not sure I'm saying that correctly, which is scheduled for a hearing tomorrow, the stakes are high. Any finding that large tech companies are liable for the content they promote or recommend, even in an automated algorithmic way, could represent a massive sea change in the way tech giants operate. In the Tomna case, the suit by the family of a Jordanian national killed in a terrorist attack alleges that Twitter wasn't sufficiently aggressive in prohibiting the Islamic State group from using that platform. It's a similar aiding and abetting issue to Gonzalez. See, that's such a reach, though. I mean, yes, do terrorist groups use platforms like Twitter for recruitment and for organizing? Of course they do. but, you know, what do you want to do? Just make it so, you know, people can't communicate and share information anymore because some people do bad things with it? You know, you can't, I mean, I hate to use, you know, you can't throw the baby out with the bathwater. It's such an old and overused cliche, but it does fit. Oh, Charles Richardson from the great state of Florida and host of the Charles Richardson Show joins us in the chat room and says, hashtag howdy, hashtag do. Let's see. Liability for user-generated content could have any number of follow-on effects, from vastly increased oversight and heavier restrictions from the internet-based companies to simply invalidating the business model for companies that rely on user-generated content to function. The justices seem to be concerned that any change to Section 230 could generate a wave of new lawsuits against big tech. Associate Justice Elena Kagan said, quote, really, anytime you have content, you would also have these precedential and prioritization choices that can be subject to suit, unquote. A decision is expected by the time the court's term ends in June. So there you go. That's, and then I want to just look at, this is from Fox. This is, this looks to be the most recent update, foxnews.com. Justices completely confused during arguments in Section 230 case against Google that could reshape the internet. Now, this goes to something. I need to take a sip of my drink here. Wow, my throat's really dry. Sorry, guys. Melanie says in the chat room, if they win, would people be able to sue religious organizations if people take their content and cause harm? I guess in theory, maybe. I don't know. I don't know what this would open up. Other than I do think it would be the end of social media. Anyway, I think it would be the end of social media anyway. There would be there will be no content anymore at this rate. Okay, we have a little bit of time left. Yeah, so justice is confused during arguments against about the Section 230 case. Justice Elena Kagan said she and her colleagues, quote, are not like the nine greatest experts on the internet, unquote. There's a reason, and we'll look at this story, but the reason that got my attention is this. I want to speak a little bit more broadly here and look just beyond this, what's happening right now in front of the Supreme Court with this case. And anybody who supports the section of 230 repeal, if you support that, if you think that's a good idea, and there's nothing I've said here today that has convinced you of otherwise, let me say this to you. I want you to think of it more broadly. If you allow Section 230 to be repealed, you're effectively allowing the government to interfere in the internet. Now, repealing Section 230 does not give the government greater powers to regulate the internet, so it's not directly giving the government more power. But you are allowing, by allowing the government to make any changes with these laws, you're giving the government the power to allow at least part of the internet to implode because it will no longer be protected. You want to, and hear me out, hear me out. If you're someone who's okay or with getting rid of 230, or if you're someone who just thinks that the government, hey, a lot of people think that the government should be doing more, maybe not repealing Section 230 necessarily, but that the government should be doing more to regulate the internet than it already does, and it doesn't do much to regulate the internet now. People think there should be more regulations and so forth. I want you to hear me out here, because I don't think so. Two things. First of all, these companies do regulate themselves to a large degree. They do. That's why people get banned all the time from various platforms, or they get suspended from various platforms. It happens all the time. People get kicked off of YouTube. People get banned from Twitter. It happens all the time, right? So obviously there's some sort of self-regulation going on here. But the other thing that I want people to understand, and it's Elena Kagan's comment that makes me think about this. Do you really trust the government to be able to prudently and competently get involved in any of this? If you do, you shouldn't. Not just because we want to keep the internet free and open and you know, allow it to continue to flourish as it does and as it has, but also you can't trust these people to make laws or any sort of regulations about the internet and expect them to actually know what the hell they're doing. And what I mean by that is this. If you really believe that Congress should be making any sort of laws about the internet, I want you to, not right now, wait till the end of the show, but I want you to go on YouTube and I want you to look up, and there are many examples, I want you to find a video of someone from big tech testifying before a congressional committee. Mark Zuckerberg, I think on more than one occasion, is gone and testified. I remember a number of years ago when Jack Dorsey was still running Twitter, he went and testified. And there's other examples of executives from big tech. It's not hard to find these videos on YouTube. Okay? Go on YouTube, look up a video of a big tech executive testifying before Congress, and pay very close attention to the questions that are being asked by these congressmen or by these senators, depending on what type of a hearing it is. Pay close attention to the questions that are being asked and the interactions that you witness during that hearing. And as you're paying very close attention to that and you're taking all that in, I want you to ask yourself, do the people sitting in this committee who are asking these questions, who are going to go on and potentially vote on laws on this very subject that this committee hearing is about, do these people asking these questions have any idea what the hell they're talking about to begin with? Do these people actually understand any of this? And again, I say it a lot these days because we have, well, we seem to be in this, hopefully the pattern will be broken, but we seem to be in the habit of electing very old people to the presidency. But so I hate to be ageist, I really do, but I have to be honest with you. I don't want octogenarians making laws having to do with modern technology. I don't. Because I promise you, no good will come of it. If you don't believe me, if you're skeptical, I dare you. As soon as this show is over, go to YouTube, find a committee hearing where Dianne Feinstein is trying to ask Mark Zuckerberg a question about how Facebook works. And then just ask yourself, do these people have any business whatsoever trying to make decisions for the rest of us about how the internet should work? Spoiler alert. They don't have any business doing that. I do not want 90-year-old Senator Chuck Grassley from Iowa voting on anything that affects me in any way, quite frankly, but especially not the internet, social media, anything having to do with anything technical, any of that. Okay? I don't. I just don't. And neither should you. Neither should you. None of us should want that, because no good will come of it. I know this for a fact. This is not my opinion. This is a fact. I will die on that hill. Jason Feddersen says, I believe they do understand. Jason, I will challenge you. After the show, please, go to YouTube, look up some big tech congressional hearing, something or other, and you'll see I'm right. You will be frightened. You will be frightened by the notion of any of these people voting on anything having to do with anything related to technology. They must not be allowed to do so. Very quickly, because we're almost out of time. So again, this is from FoxNews.com. The Supreme Court heard oral arguments today in the first two cases. I say that word funny, don't I? Earl. It's oral. Arguments today in the first of two cases this week that explore the extent of legal protections given to tech companies that provide a platform for third-party users. All right, some of this we already know. I'm going to skip down, and we're running out of time anyway. Okay. Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act says sites like YouTube, Google, Facebook, and Twitter are immune to legal claims based on the content posted by their users. Oh, JFed says it's because of Bruce. That's right. Bruce! We hate Bruce. By the way, if you're new to the show, no offense to anyone named Bruce. We're not talking about you unless you're the Bruce. Then we have a problem. The justices and parties involved wrestled with whether the way in which the content is presented is itself a form of speech and whether it is via clear recommendations or an algorithm. Whether it is via clear recommendations or an algorithm, the algorithm is what creates the recommendations. See, they don't get it. They don't get it. They don't get it. They don't get it. And they're going to be voting on this case. They don't understand what they're doing. Justice Elena Kagan said, quote, I mean, we're a court. We really don't know about these things. You know, these are not like the nine greatest experts on the internet, unquote. Hey, at least she said it. You'll never hear a congressman or a senator say that. At least she said it. Yeah, we're talking about the internet. Hey, guess what? We got to make a decision on this case, but we have no idea what any of this is really about, do we? we don't know. We don't know. What do you want from us? We have no idea. Well, then kick it down to a lower court. I don't know. What are you even doing with this case then? If you can't understand it, are you going to try to learn? Maybe you'll try to learn about it. Maybe you can all learn. Minutes earlier, Justice Samuel Alito told the plaintiff's attorney, Eric Schnapper, he was, quote, completely confused by whatever argument you're making at the present time, unquote. Schnapper had been discussing how YouTube presents thumbnail images and links to different videos when providing search results or content that an algorithm believes a user might want. Schnapper argued that while the videos themselves are created by users, the thumbnails themselves are joint creations of the user and YouTube, piercing YouTube Section 230 protection. Right. Because you post a video to YouTube and then YouTube generates a thumbnail, which you do have some control over. Or you can just let YouTube handle it. Schnapper's argument doesn't hold up. That does not pierce Section 230's protections at all. But if Samuel Alito can't comprehend what Schnapper is saying, then, well, that's a problem. Later on, Google attorney Lisa Blatt dismissed the argument by noting that it was never part of the plaintiff's complaint. in the case. Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson, like Alito earlier, said at one point she was thoroughly confused by what was being argued because she believed the relevant issue was the scope of Section 230 immunity, not what might trigger liability. Schnapper noted that it comes down to how certain actions or practices are viewed in terms of being covered by the law. Quote, the contention we're advancing is that a variety of things that we're loosely characterizing as recommendations fall outside of the statute, unquote, Schnapper told Jackson, summing up a central focus of the day's arguments. Well, okay, so she's questioning, she's not understanding his argument. It's not that she's not understanding. I mean, she's the youngest one on the court, right? So again, I'm sorry to be ageist. I don't mean to be, but let's be honest. If she's the youngest one there, she's the most likely to get it. It's not to say that the people there who are older are not smart enough to get it. Please don't anyone misunderstand me. But when it comes to technology, young people tend to understand it more. I mean, some of these justices have probably never even gone to YouTube. Okay? So I'm just being honest. I hope this all gets thrown out. There's more here, but we don't have time. We are out of time. Out of time! All right, if you miss any part of today's show, it will be up in just a little bit at WMNHradio.org and my website, MattConnerton.com. And that's going to do it for me for now. Don't forget, tomorrow we will share Eric Pilcher's classic film review of the film Juice. Really looking forward to that. And yeah, we are absolutely out of time. I got to get out of here. I'll talk to y'all a little bit later. Bye, everybody.